superintendent of HR in Avondale and in West Bloomfield. Through those experiences and our networks of contacts, we have learned that separating applicants from candidates is all about the profile. Saying that, after you secure the Metro Bureau Search Services, we will begin the process with an initial board study session, with the main objective being the creation of the profile for the next superintendent of Lawrence Spruce Public Schools. It is very satisfying when you find the right person. We will also establish a search timeline, and we recommend community forums, which include the community at large and above employee groups, which will include an online survey. It's important to include the community in the process. We will share the results of the survey and the forums with the board and the community, which again is very, very important, especially with a district of this size, to get the community involved and understand what the process is. I can't emphasize that enough. And now Nancy will take you through the process with more specifics.
Thank you, Tony, and good evening, everyone. In the documentation that we sent to you, you received a timeline template, that's what we call it, that we put in our introductory packet from the Metro Bureau. And we believe in starting with the end in mind. And so once the board tells us the date that you want to have a new superintendent in place, we will work backwards with you to zero in on what must happen in each week to meet that date. Specific dates to have items on the timeline completed will make everyone's job go smoothly and will keep our commitment to your stakeholders to finalize the process. Once you agree to the dates and the timeline, we work on that together, that will be posted on your website and available to everyone. There are three phases to the superintendent search process. The first is marketing and recruiting. At the initial board study session, you will share what skills, talents, experiences, etc. you want in your next superintendent. Because we know your parents, union leadership, staff, and community members will want input on this matter as well, we will schedule several community forums, as many as you wish, to get you their thoughts. We also know some people, no matter how many dates and how many forums they have, will be unable to attend. So we will have a survey on your website, as well as paper copies of the survey in all of your school offices, so people can share their thoughts. They can submit them to us electronically or even in an envelope. We will combine all that information and also research that we've collected over the years on the superintendent's role and desired skill sets. Believe it or not, there's research on everything. And we work with you to create that superintendent candidate profile. We know you want the applicants to familiarize themselves with your community and your district, so we put together a 2-by-8.5x11 sheet of information, and we glean that information from your township's website, your Chamber of Commerce, your district website, and we will be sure to include the points of pride that you included in your request for proposals to us. We haven't seen anything that documented and that clear in any of our other previous communications from other districts, so I just want you to know we were very impressed. We'll drive something up. Everything will be in draft form until we meet with you to get your approval. We may, at the end of work, think about something else that you want in that brochure. So once you tell us what you want, we'll print that 2-sided flyer brochure. We can kind of use those terms interchangeably. And we have a copy of one that we've done previously in the packet that we sent you. We'll distribute that electronically to every district in the state, MASA, local universities, and we'll place it on our Metro Bureau website. We cast a really broad net because we want everyone who has an interest in applying for your superintendent's position to have the information they need to make that decision to apply. Phase one is complete once the deadline for applications is passed, and again, that date will be set by you, the board. Phase two of the process is called initial selection. The first screening involves the Metro Bureau reviewing each applicant's application submission, conducting reference checks as listed by the applicant, and there must be two or three references listed, but one reference must be their current supervisor. And we also check credentials, their teaching and their administrative credentials with the state, and check on those. Kyle calls each applicant personally, and he conducts a phone interview. All of this results in the Metro Bureau meeting with you again at a second board study session to share information on the candidates and get approval for the 5 to 8 applicants that you want us to call for that first level interview. Also at that session, we review questions and a rating system to be used by you, the board members, for the interviews. We have prepared questions, and we've used these in the past, and we feel that they elicit the information you need to shape your decisions. But you may ask us to write additional questions because you are unique, you're the next cruise. If you ask us to write additional questions, of course we will, and we want those to cover any focus areas that you feel are important. Phase 3 is the final phase, and it actually begins with conducting those first interviews. From that round, the board will determine which candidates to ask back for a second interview. The board may want to visit the candidates' districts, and we will work with you to arrange that. After second interviews, the boards will make their selection, and with the assistance of your attorney, we will work with the board to create a contract within the parameters that you give us. Once an employment contract is prepared and agreed upon by the finalist, the board will approve the final selection and the actual employment contract. The final piece is working with you to introduce your new superintendent to your community. This can occur in a press release and/or a meet and greet. We also include a board superintendent retreat, and usually do that a month or two after you have your new superintendent in place. And that's a nice time to do some goal setting together, and we work with you on that. That's included. I'll end my piece by stating the Board of Education's relationship with the superintendent is the most important relationship in your whole organization. If you work together like a hand in a glove, you will continue to do great things for your students, your parents, your staff, and your community. And I'll turn it back to Carl.
Thank you, Nancy. And in closing, real briefly, I'm not sure which firms you interviewed last night. You know the firms that that you interviewed tonight. We see them in a lot of the same places. And I will tell you that you have some great firms, and I'm sure last night was no different than tonight. So why us? What's unique about the Metro Bureau, again, is we are an anchor firm into this region. We know the districts, we know the people, we know people who want to be superintendents. We also know a number of retired superintendents who probably would like to be an interim for a short period of time, which would be a new situation. So we have those connections, and you know, and I'm not sure how many of you were on the board when the last time the board did superintendent search, but I know some of you have never been through this process before, and some of you have. And so one of the things that we do is we customize our process to make sure that we meet your needs. So whether there are things that you want to do personally that may involve a little bit more than other boards would like, that's all okay with us. We feel like our job is to serve your needs. We'll advise you on the pros and cons of any strategy or any process that you'd like help with. And we'll tell you about that, but we like to make sure that we're meeting your needs. This is a very fine district. You're going to attract some wonderful candidates. I'm really confident of that. Even though Michigan is not considered to be the most desirable state in the country now for educators, you're still going to attract people from far and wide. We have the capacity to market nationally, regionally, and locally. We're very well networked at all levels. So we know the region, we take the time to get to know the board and the district, and we get to know the candidates. We get to know the candidates. You mentioned that I personally conduct a phone interview with all of the qualified candidates to meet your requirements. And part of what I'm doing is getting to know them, but a big part of what I'm doing is assessing their leadership skills. We look for 7 leadership traits in our screening interviews. We look for things like integrity, mission, passion. We also look for courage, empathy, and relationship skills. Now, those things are all important in this job. You know, the superintendent wears a lot of hats, even in a large district like this, maybe especially in a large district like this, but without those relationships, their effectiveness is going to be hampered. As Nancy mentioned, they need to be, they can get effective relationships with all seven youth, you're the district leadership team, the board and the superintendent. And we do that. The other thing that we do is we see three things through 3M. Most superintendent search firms do not help with contract negotiations. We work directly with either the board president or our designated subcommittee of the board to make sure that, that we know the contract parameters include salary and calendar and benefits and all those things. And we make that very apparent to people before the interview process. You know, our worst nightmare is that someone comes in here and thinks that they're going to make $400,000 a year because it's a big district and you have nice buildings that all look new and fresh. And although we have a national discussion, but I'm pretty sure that's not the case. And so we don't want any surprises at the end. We don't want anybody backing out at the last minute saying, well, I thought it was so wonderful that they would double their salary for me. What do you mean they wouldn't do that? So that's our worst nightmare, not only your worst nightmare, it's our worst nightmare too. So we take the time again to do everything humanly possible to prevent those kind of meltdowns in the end. And with that said, you probably have a few questions you'd like to ask us. Yes?
What are the two most common failures of the school board in consideration of the selection of a new superintendent in your experience?
Well, as you know, this is a very high-stakes decision. And I don't think that any of you have been involved in probably selection of more than one, maybe two superintendents in your entire tenure on the board. So experience is definitely a factor. And one of the most important things that a search firm can do is use our experience to help make up for your inexperience. Again, not just doing what the board wants us to do, but advising the board on the pros and cons. Let's take, for example, salary. We're in a very cost-conscious age here in Michigan, especially so with educators and education. Yet, this is a big job. This is your chief executive. A big part of our role is to help you in making sure that the salary you set doesn't limit your opportunities for getting the right person for the job. So I would say, being cost-conscious at the expense of everything else is probably one of the most common mistakes that a board can make. We're going to ask you for some flexibility because we know the market, because that's what we do is conduct market research surveys. We know the salaries in our region, we know the salaries across the state. Before we ask you to work with us on salary, we're going to need the research data on midpoint in Macomb County, on the midpoint in our region, and the midpoint in our state. You may say we want to be at the midpoint, or you may say we want to be above the midpoint. We want to be in 75% of that. We want our superintendent, because we're a larger district, they should make one in 3/4 of the other districts in the state. Or you may go the other way. I know money is tight here, enrollment is an issue in this district, and you may have to cut corners there, but we're here to advise you on those types of things. Probably the second most common mistake is we work with the board on setting a process. Once you have a good process in place, you have to trust the process to get you to the right candidate and the right finalist. And it's very easy to go sideways on that. Somebody in the community that you know and trust whispers in your ear something, or you hear a rumor about a candidate who on first round interviewed very, very well. We check all that stuff out for you. We don't want you to have any surprises, but we communicate with you every step of the way. We give you progress reports, and we give you ample opportunities to communicate with us on things that you hear, because it's very normal for people to whisper you. That's what you're for. You represent the community. You want that going on. You want people pointing you in the grocery store. Maybe not every day, but it's important. It's important to hear what the people want, and you take that under advisement. But at the end of the day, it's your job to select the superintendent, not the communities. Use that information from the community to inform your decision. And that's how we have to work.
I think I heard the answer to this, but I just want to, I'm just going to ask this question anyway. What are the benefits of using a regional versus a national-based firm in your experience?
Probably the biggest benefit would be that we know the needs of these school districts. We work regularly with administrators at all three counties, you know, and again, we are different. You may want a fresh face from out of town. And that's good. You just have to get that person once they're on job time to adjust to the community. And we can help in terms of structuring the interview questions. We can help get you a very good idea that will predict how that person is going to act in the community, get appointed, and what their level of involvement is going to be. So again, knowledge of the region, I think, is probably one of the biggest assets. And knowing people who are superintendents who may be looking to go from a small district to a larger district, people that want to be a first-time superintendent who would make a very good candidate, if that's something that the board wants. And again, some boards, especially in larger districts, feel that it's wrong to outline some of the superintendent experiences. That's not ill-advised.
Well, what type of background and reference check do you do, and cost involved?
Well, first of all, our cost is all inclusive. As far as background checks, we have a team, Tony, Doug, and Nancy, all three of them work on those. We check references personally. We ask, you know, every application, every firm uses, asks for references. If the immediate supervisor of that person is not listed on the reference, that's probably our first call. When I do my phone screen, I ask every candidate if there's somebody they don't want us to call. Because I don't like to surprise them, but it's our job to know everything we can about them so we can tell you, if there are people that were in leadership positions in school districts for more than 10 minutes, they have baggage. Guess what? Not everybody likes their decision making. That's all going to come out. And it's going to come to you through some of your union leadership because they check out their districts. They want to know, they want to know. They want to know. But all that's going to come out. It's our job to know everything. So in addition to asking them to tell me, what was your biggest failure? What's the one thing that the board is probably going to find out in Las Cruz that is really going to embarrass you? Because give us a chance to reflect. We'll decide if that rules you out as a candidate. It may be ugly enough that we think, there's a little radioactivity here. We need to let that settle down for a few more years. Or we may leave it up to the board. Say, look, this is what we found out. Otherwise, this is a very good candidate. But here's some things that you're going to hear about with this candidate. Do you want to take that chance? And you may not. But again, that's your decision because if they get the job, you're going to own that decision.
I believe the answer to this question, too, is that what is your role in negotiating a new superintendent contract? And I think what you put here to say was that you work directly with the board on developing the contract.
Right. We created the overall parameters early on, as I mentioned earlier, so that we can share them with, we don't want anybody to interview unless they're willing to come work for those working conditions that you're willing to offer. That's very important. Some boards like to keep the same contract they have, some want to start from scratch. We'll work with you on creating those parameters. We're not attorneys, we don't try to be. So it's really the job of your attorney to write that contract because they're going to be the ones that are defending you if something melts down and you go to court. So we work hand in hand with the attorney through the entire process, along with the candidate, keeping them updated too.
Okay. What clerical support are you expecting from the district?
Good question. I'm not sure if you noticed, but in our proposal, there's a bar graph that shows kind of a time estimate of the time that the consultants put in, the time that the board puts in the process, and the time that the district personnel put in. We rely on district support for making copies if we're going to do a community meeting and we expect a couple hundred people. We use that. Probably the most important thing though is we ask them to appoint a liaison who we deal with, someone who works in the district every day. Sometimes it is the board president. But more often than not, it's the administrative assistant to the superintendent and the board. That's the person who knows the job well, who knows you fairly well, and knows the demands of the district very well. That's probably the most common person. All in all, we try not to be because we know all these people have day jobs. We try not to take up too much of their time any more than is absolutely necessary. It's usually just coordination, making sure that we have everything buttoned down for an upcoming board study session, making sure that there's some cookies and coffee for a community meeting, those types of things. You know, because people are usually coming in after work, we have to treat them this way. And they may not need it. It's nice to have you. It says that, hey, we're respectful of your time. We appreciate you coming in. And it's also communicating with the board, helping us to make sure we get emails out to you on the process as it unfolds.
And the follow-up to that is that the clerical support provider where you're from, explain that, and then you said the cost is all-inclusive, correct?
So that's correct. The only thing we charge extra for, and I'm not sure if you want to know, last time you did a national search. If you are going to do a national search, first thing, almost everything is electronic, and there's no charge for posting in other areas of the country. The only charge is posting in national publications, paper publications like Education Week and Leadership, and we would bill you just for our costs. If on the other hand, we have a candidate who's in Southern California, somewhere else, and for a variety of reasons they're not able to come here, and you want us to go out and meet with them, you know, we would have the ability for that too. We're not prepared to incur those costs. Otherwise, everything is included.
What is the average tenure for a city superintendent?
You know, if you look at the state average, it's about 5 years. If you look at our region, it's less than 4 years. And so probably one of the most important things for this district, I kind of group school districts over 10,000, under 10,000, and you're getting close to the cusp there. But you would still be in our over 10,000 district group. And the tenure is normally a little bit longer. It's normally 5 years for districts over 10,000. Because in our region, we have a lot of very needy, very high-risk districts, and most of them tend to be pretty small. That kind of skews the regional data a little bit.
And what about for Superintendent View Place? Are you aware of last Superintendent View Place or their tenure, like, retention was?
Well, we started doing this 3 years ago, and our very first placement is still alive and well and working as a superintendent in the district that we placed. Our most recent superintendent search, we just finished at the end of the school year doing South Lake in your county. So his training wheels are coming off in a few months, but it's still pretty early to tell, but we have very good longevity. Again, I think every search firm you're probably interviewing does is, if there's a meltdown that first year and either the candidate doesn't stay or the board doesn't want that candidate to stay, we are happy to step in and do whatever you want us to do at that point. And even if that includes a warranty job and doing the whole thing over, we will do it, and we will do it with a smile on our face, with every bit of energy that we did the first time around. We feel that we owe that to you because you're a member of our organization, and because most of the districts that we work with are members of our organization, we have a vested interest in a nice long-term relationship that's productive and purposeful.
And what would your cost be for that?
That's a warranty job, no charge. The only thing we charge is for any additional expenses for copies, no incidents, that's all. So be very minor.
So we're looking for an interim superintendent, right? So our superintendent's meeting at the end of this year.
Right.
Are you aware of that next, that cost is in your proposal for?
It is.
Okay.
That's included in.
Okay. All right, and then questions for Sharon?
Okay, yes. We all know that sometimes when people are out looking for jobs, especially when you are in a higher level job, we also know that the roles, but sometimes somebody doesn't want their current supervisor to know that they're looking. And I appreciate that that might be something that was not some red flags for you right away, like, huh, what's going on here? And it might just be as simple as, I don't even know yet. So, if you get a candidate that might fit what we need and they don't want you to contact the current supervisor, would you come back to us and say, this is what we've got, what we're willing to, whatever, or what would you do?
That's a very good question, and I would say that probably 95% of candidates don't want their supervisors to know. Even more so, 100% of city superintendents hadn't necessarily told the board at that point. So there's a couple of things. There's being respectful of the candidates, because guess what? They're not going to work with us if we treat them, you know, if their name is in the paper the day after we get their application and they don't even get an interview, you know, that's really not the next, it's not a nice way to operate, it's not friendly. And people will shy away from search firm. Does that? Some state laws require that. Michigan doesn't. We're governed by the Open Meetings Act, and we're compliant with that, which basically says that nothing needs to become public until the first round of interviews begin. And we respect that. Again, the only thing we thought about candidates, and I kind of alluded to this earlier when we talked about my phone interviews, I let them know that we're going to start checking references right after I speak with them. Have you told your boss? Have you told your board? Or at least your board president? They know, because that's not a good surprise to get a call from a search firm that they're looking. And so that's kind of how we operate.
You know, we really, and I should say Carl. Carl has a very honest discussion with them about how serious they are about leaving their district. We want to make sure that they really, especially we think that they're a fantastic fit for Lance Cruz. And we kind of tip our head a little bit too, and we say, listen, out of, you know, 28 applications, you're like in the top four. So we would encourage them to come forward again to the board president. In confidentiality, because we're going to keep in confidence. And I think we've been very successful because of, I think our people know us, and they know that we'll keep it confidential, and boards are confidential as well. That's what you do every day in your job. So it's worked out well for us so far, that's what I would say.
Okay. And just one other good thing I'll add, and is some people apply, but they're really not ready to move. Maybe they want to go practice interviewing. That would be a very naive reason to interview and take the time of seven people and community members, but some people believe they're not doing that. If someone is ready to tell their boss, they really don't want the job.
Okay, thank you.
And we've had a couple conversations with people, and I've said, look, if that's the case, you know, and very nice to them, I say, you know, let's talk again when you're really ready to move, because I'm not hearing you.
Question. In looking at your proposal, under screening and selection criteria, there's a paragraph here, if I may read it, that says the credentials of the candidates will be reviewed with the board during a screening session that is compliant with state and federal statutory union requirements. Does that mean that you will talk to us about the candidates in a closed session?
Very good question. And again, that's at the prerogative of the board, but here's what happens. One of the things we also have to do is protect all of you. What you don't want is a whispering campaign going around the district that this was a done deal before they started. Everybody wanted Shane over from the middle school to get the job. And this was all a waste of money and a big song and dance. So one of the things that we can do is kind of diffuse that situation a little bit with our process. That is done during a closed session, that's the short answer. The way we can do that and be compliant with the Open Meetings Act is we go into closed session under written opinion of counsel, which is a review of the Open Meetings Act, and you review credentials. Now, some boards want to be involved in looking at every applicant. We don't recommend that. We're the professionals, we do this for a living. As Tony mentioned, we all have extensive HR backgrounds. There's going to be a number of applicants, as Tony mentioned, that really aren't candidates, except in their own mind. And so we like to make that kind of painless for everybody. We give them a nice polite phone call and thank them, but let them know that they just don't meet the criteria. But you know, that doesn't mean never, you know, come back in the future after you've had a little more central office experience or something. But so what we do is, with your permission, we select a pool of candidates from that field of applicants who meet your criteria, we feel represent the best and the brightest. We may come to you and say, you know, I don't think any of these candidates are any good. I think we should go back to the well and post a little longer. And you've got a nice long period. I'm assuming you get a qualified intern in. As you probably know, superintendent season starts in January, and usually tapers off around May. So like you're running, there's a season, no bullets hopefully, but there is a season for this. But you've got an action getting into this early, which is the right thing to do. So what we do is we redact the names from those credentials. So you don't even know who it is. Now, if you're a detective, and if you read through the resumes, and someone works at one of your schools as a principal, you're going to know, guess what? But because we never discuss the name, and we ask that you never discuss the name with anybody, we're still compliant with the Open Meetings Act. And so it's not until we make an announcement, which we try to keep very close to interview time, so maybe a day or a couple days before the first night of interviews, we make a press release for the board to use for your district communications, and if you communicate with a local paper, if not, if you want us to, we do that. Announcing the candidates and the times, and you all come. We want everybody is welcome. We want you here. We want you here with the people that are interested in being in our future. Did I answer everything else?
Hold on. There's one more.
Process today. Is that when we do the community forums, we explain the process to the community so they know what's going on. It's not a big surprise. It's very important to get the community involved and know what's going on. So the more they know, the more we can tell them without violating our confidence with you, the better off we all are. So the community knowing the process is very, very important.
Your firm seems to provide transcendent guidance to the process, more, I think, than we've heard with other firms. I said your firm seems to provide a significant amount of guidance, or a tremendous amount, probably more than we've heard from other firms. You are suggesting a limited candidate pool. You bring us 10, approximately 10 candidates that you select from the criteria that we set forth. My concern is I'm taking a look at your time allocation card, chart that's here on, I think it's on page 5. You are allocating the same amount of time for district personnel as you are for the Board of Education in this process. What is it that you are expecting with the district personnel that would create as large of a time allocation as for this board to be responsible for making this decision?
Very good question. That's something that varies a little bit. Again, this is an estimate that varies a little bit. And I don't know Nikki very well. I've spoken with her on the phone through the years, but I've never met her personally. I don't know whether she's 30 or 60, how long she's staying on. But normally, we encourage the board secretary to be a part of the process. We think it's important for them to be in attendance at the interviews. We like to talk to them a little bit about their opinions on things too, because they're the person who works the most closely with the superintendent. And when that relationship is strong, and when it's good, and when there's trust there, that helps. And that cascades up to the board level as well. So that's why it's about the same as for the board. They wouldn't necessarily be at a study session. Again, the rules on that are governed by the board. A closed session is wherever you want to be in that meeting. So if the secretary is interested and willing, administrative assistant is interested and willing, and the board wants it that way, we have it that way, but it's not a problem.
And would you recommend the same involvement from the administrative assistant if they are currently working for the superintendent that's being replaced?
I would stress confidentiality, and I think if that administrative assistant is planning on staying on afterwards, I would hope, first of all, that's the person who I would think already knows what confidentiality means, because there's a lot of fuss that goes into that position. And I would think that person would be very likely to respect that confidentiality. But again, all of you know that person better than I do, and that would probably govern your decision.
Have you been in that situation before? Because my concern would be that it would put that administrative assistant in a bad position. In a very difficult position, at the very least.
I've never had it perceived that way. We normally have a talk with the outgoing superintendent making sure that they're familiar with the process and the requirements and the confidentiality. And believe it or not, most superintendents steer clear of that, which is wise, because that's one person too many. You know, some people like to have a hand in picking their successor, but that's not well advised. It really isn't. So again, that's something that's a little nuanced with each district. I will tell you, our most recent search, the administrative assistant was not involved much at all. That was her choice, and that was okay with the board. We didn't delve any deeper than that. But it's not typical, I'll just tell you that much.
Thank you. You said you do a reference check. What about a criminal check and a financial check?
We don't do a comprehensive financial check. We don't have the capability. However, I will tell you, one of our business partners does, and that's something that the board would want. We're happy to have that done. We can contract with one of our business partners to do that kind of thing, as well as the criminal background check. Because of the school employee, they've already been through the criminal background check, and their records are checked 3 times a year through the FBI and the, you know, the criminal system, so that if anything comes up after you've hired them, the school district would get that information. So that part is already pretty much done. On a candidate that comes from out of state, we'd have to check to see what the requirements are, but my understanding is that most states have a very similar process. It's kind of a national system that comes into play there. But again, if that's something, particularly with an out-of-state candidate, because sometimes there are things that don't show up on Google, and that some of the reference checks just will not tell us. We can't assume that they're all going to come clean with someone we've never met or a long distance call.
Good. Anybody else? Okay, if you have any closing remarks, as you make these times. So.
No, actually, I made them before. Again, we appreciate the opportunity and know that our team will work very hard for you. And whether you select us or another firm, we wish you the absolute best. You're important to us.